The space was really what was getting us. We specialize. We do one thing, we do it really freaking good. In every other industry, prices go up. Spread the wealth. Your team has to be supporting and to support the communities that we're connected with.
Hey everyone, Dave Menz, Laundromat Millionaire, coming to you again from the beautiful city of Cincinnati, Ohio, as my wife laughs as I say that. We're back for another awesome episode of our podcast, and we are excited for the guest that we have with you today. Carla's going to introduce him in a minute, but the fact of the matter is, he's a rock star in our industry. A lot of people don't know who he is, but a lot of people do. The people that do, they're finding out very quickly how smart the guy is, and his business model is unique. It's different, and so that's what we love to do, is we love to challenge each other. There is no status quo in the industry. We're always trying to grow. It's that abundance mindset, and the more that we bring others that challenge that status quo into the industry and on platforms like this, it makes us all better. So anyway, we're glad that you all are here today. We think you're going to get a lot of this episode. So Carla, do you want to introduce our guest?
Yes. And I was just going to add to what you were saying. Something I love about this is that his model's different. And I think It really shows that in the laundromat industry, you can make the business your own. There's not just one model. And I think that's one of the great things about our industry. But going into who we have today, I'm excited for our guest. Our guest today is Waleed Cope. He is the co-founder of The Soapbox in Brooklyn, New York. And it is a full-service garment and sneaker care business focusing on drop-off and pickup and delivery. So Waleed, welcome to our show.
Thank you so much, Dave and Carl, for having me.
We appreciate you being here, man. And I got to say, you know someone is a cool dude when they can pull off a suit with sneakers. I mean, I'm just not a fashion guy. I'm just a t-shirt kind of guy, Waleed. When you know, for those of you that don't know what I'm referencing, he does. Waleed was a speaker on, he was a panelist at our most recent Laundromat Millionaire Conference in 2022. And he brought a lot of value to the stage. And I'm sitting there at my table just listening to all the wisdom from the panel. And I'm just kind of like, I'm a Midwest guy who's just a t-shirt and shorts or sweatpants kind of guy. And I'm just cracking up because he's up there all decked out with his suit on and the whole nine yards. And I look down and he's got sneakers on.
Well, he had to show off his sneaker care.
I mean, he pulled it off.
Thank you.
I'm not picking at all. I think he totally pulled it off. I like, not my world, but man, you were rocking it. You looked awesome, dude. Thanks for being here, my friend. Listen, let's get into it. Okay. You ready for this?
Let's go. And I just want to say, before we jump in, you know, Dave and Carla, I want to go on the record publicly and just say thank you so much for allowing myself and my team to be a part of the Laundromat Millionaire Conference. It was a great opportunity. We had a great time. We met great people. And we were just so grateful that you allowed us to be part of the inaugural event. And it was a blast.
Well, you and your wife were part of what made it great. Mm-hmm. You're awesome up there.
Man, let's jump into it because I know we have a ton to talk about. There's a ton of wisdom and there's a lot of uniqueness to your story and your business model that we just want to throw the value at the viewers. Listen, what we like people to do when we start the show is just to give us a little bit of a backstory of kind of who you are and what your childhood was like. Like, did you grow up where you live now? What was your household like? What made Waleed Cope who you are today?
Yeah, so that I don't want to take up too much time on the episode, but it's. I grew up Brooklyn, New York, born and raised. I've left and come back, so I still live in my childhood neighborhood, and the soapbox is located in my childhood neighborhood. So we have a lot of history, a lot of foundation, a lot of connections to the community here. I grew up Bedford-Stuyvesant, Brooklyn. With my siblings, my mother was a public school teacher and my dad's an entrepreneur. So I grew up in single parent household. My mom raised all of us, made all the sacrifices, did the whole nine yards to get us where we are today. As a public school teacher, though, I ended up with extra siblings because she brought some students home, never left. So I ended up with an extra sister and a brother. So it was awesome. Wouldn't trade experience for the world. I was fortunate enough, even though I grew up in a single parent household, my dad's business was one block away from
Oh, really?
my childhood home. So I could easily just walk down the street, go see my dad, spend quality time there, be hands-on in the business. And what was even better, my grandparents lived on the block between my childhood home and my dad's business. So I could totally just walk down the block thinking I was unsupervised, but my grandparents were in the middle of the block watching me right. as I walked to the store. So, you know, it played a great role in growing up, spending time in the business, getting exposed to it. And then, you know, being in a home with my mother, sacrificed, did all the things she needed to do to make sure we had a good foundation for myself and my siblings.
So I got to know, what was your dad's business like? You said he owned his own business too?
Correct. So my dad, it was awesome story. The condensed version is my dad and my two uncles went into business. My uncle got hurt at work one day and he got some kind of like workers' comp settlement or something. They paid him a lump sum of money for his injury at work. And the three of them sat around and was like, we should go into business. And they decided to open up a meat market in our neighborhood. And it was like super small, actually smaller than the soapbox. It was like maybe 300-400 square feet. And they just started there. And then as they grew, their focus was just get prime cut meats, premium to serve clients. And then from there, they expanded, they got more room and they opened up and they got into the supermarket business. And then from there, it just expanded. They got into, my dad got into real estate, a couple other businesses and just kept growing over time. Mm-hmm. And when they decided to expand the supermarket and move into another location, the building that they purchased had a laundromat and a barbershop in the back. Mm-hmm. For some reason, to this day, I have no idea why, they decided to keep the laundromat and get rid of the barbershop. And I'm so happy they did, because I don't think I'll be good at cutting hair.
I'm really good. Yeah. I get them all.
Yeah, well, yeah. That's when you, because you focus, you get on one, you focus on one type of haircut, you niche down. So yeah,
that's right. That's right.
Yeah. So I spent time running between the supermarket, which was in the front part of the building, and then the laundromat. Mm-hmm. The laundromat, like when he got it, it was a total, like a disaster. The tiles were coming off the floor, like half the machines didn't work. So over time, him and my uncles, they spent energy and money learning the business, evolving it over time. Mm-hmm. And I'd probably say it was like, you know, 25 plus years that they ran the laundromat.
Oh, they did. So how old were you when they acquired this again?
I'll be lying. I don't remember. Let's just say roughly 30 years ago. Well, we've been in the business plus 30 years. So maybe I was like around, I don't know, 10.
Okay. So it was like the middle of your childhood. Okay. Gotcha.
Yeah. I was still young. Like yeah. I was in the supermarket eating stuff. And he's like, you're eating the profits. I'm like, what a profits? Like, what the hell is that?
They're free, Dad. They're free. What are you talking about?
It's like, we own it. It's free. He's like, you're eating the profits. And I'm like, whatever. Sorry,
Carla. No. So the laundromat in the back, that's obviously where you started learning the laundry business. Did you eventually take over that laundromat or open your own? Like, what was the transition then?
So it's family dynamics. I worked in and out of business. Like, what, I would be there like a year and we would be doing things. And I'd be like, Dad, we should do X. Like, we should get computers or we should run promotions. We should modernize. He'd be like, no, like, let's focus on this, blah, blah, blah. And I'd be like, okay. And then be like, I quit. And then like a couple of years later, I come back and we'll go through that whole scenario again. And I'd be like, I quit. Like, so finally, after my last quit, I came back around like 2015. I got some calls from like friends and families. It was like, yeah, Dad's in the store all the time. And I was just like, yeah, well, you know, that's what he likes to do, whatever. And they were like, no, you should go by. So I went there. I saw my dad. He was like, my dad is like the true micromanager. Like he has a ton of cameras in the store. He has like 20 monitors up and he's like, gets on the phone. Hello, Susan. Why did you not fold that shirt according to the guidelines? Like 1 inch here and 1 inch. And I'm like, Dad, what are you doing?
And you didn't like working for him?
No. No. He's a great entrepreneur, great teacher and everything. But it's just his style. Like, I'm not a micromanager. And like some people can operate under that and some people can't. Yeah. So it had gotten to the point where he was doing a majority of the work at the store. And I was like, that, like, you can't do it. We talked for a while. I went home and I was like, hey, Jess, would you like to get into the laundromat business full time? And she was like, what's the idea? So we talked about it and we went back, had a meeting with my dad. So in 2015, we took over 100% from my dad.
Okay. So Jess is your wife. That's who you're referring to, right, Jessica?
Correct.
Yeah. Okay.
Wife and business partner.
Wife and business partner. And she is an entrepreneur in her own right, correct? Because you made that sound real easy. You were just like, hey, Jess, want to buy a laundromat? She was like, sure, why not? That's not how that works, Waleed. That's not how that works.
Not how ours works.
I'm sorry to say, it works like that in our household.
Good for you. That's awesome. The good news is it pretty much works that way now.
Yeah.
But it took me 12 years. That first one, she was like, what are you doing? Are you out of your mind?
I've heard some of the stories, Carla, so I totally understand.
Yeah, absolutely. So it was a little easier sell to a fellow entrepreneur that you were married to. So what was the laundromat like in 2015? What did you acquire? Was it the Taj Mahal of all laundromats at that point?
It was like, listen, my dad kept it in good condition, but it had turned into basically like a one-man show with a couple team members versus to what it was over time. We have 27 washers and 28 dryers. And our store was an L shape because we expanded. We had the fortune, being fortunate enough to own the building. So we took the barbershop space a long time ago and added it to the laundromat.
Okay.
And then over time, my dad retired from the supermarket business. So we took some space from the supermarket when we transitioned out of that and started leasing that space and added that space to the laundromat to make it. So it was an L-shaped store. The store is probably, I'd say 2,700 square feet roughly.
Okay.
But it's not the typical New York City laundromat where in New York City, we have row houses and everything is side by side. And you typically walk in and it's washers on one side, dryers on the other side. And it's just, you know, straight
that
walk.
Shotgun store. Yeah,
exactly. Where our store was on the avenue because it was a corner building, which made it good for us.
Okay.
So the store, when you walked in, you could either go to the left and you would walk straight down. We had dryers on the back wall and washers on the front wall. And then when you walked to the rear of the store, it was an L shape. So then we just had washers going straight down on both walls. Mm-hmm. So it was an advantage to us to be one, own the building, and two, be on a corner. That was okay. Huge for us.
And is that big for New York City? I mean, I know there's some, just because there's so many people, I know there's some like big mats on you know, big streets.
Huge.
But I also hear that a lot of them are real small too.
Yeah, a lot of, you know, small. They're in a footprint of maybe 20 feet wide, 40 feet deep, which is a typical, you know, New York City mixed-use building. Mm-hmm. But there are some big players in our industry, make no mistake. They have, you know, 3,000-4,000 square feet. Like in little strip malls or like shopping centers throughout. Mm-hmm. But I'd say we're probably on a small to mid-size compared to what the norm is in New York City. You know, you mentioned the condition. Listen, the store was in fair condition. Our machines were probably 20 years old at that point.
Okay.
We had Wascomat Gen 3s, I think. Yeah.
Okay.
So
solid machines.
ABC dryers. Yeah, they were workhorses. Mm-hmm. They would go. They were easy to repair. The thing is, they're just not efficient. Like you're talking gallons of water running through those machines.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So this L-shaped laundromat that you had, it was just a self-service. Did you have drop-off as well?
So yeah, we had drop-off. If we rewind back to when I was there with my dad leaving, so we were doing drop-off. Not on a huge scale, but we were doing drop-off. We had computerized it before my last quit, and which made things a lot more streamlined because you know how it is in the industry. We had the ticket books with duplicate tickets here. You take the yellow slip, we keep the other two. So we had drop off and just self-service. That's it.
Are you renovating your store or building a new one? Tired of persistent and expensive plumbing issues like I was? Get an HM Company drain trough to give those drain lines a fighting chance against the constant wear and tear of laundromat life. Sizing is fully customizable to meet your needs, and lead times are a maximum of 2 weeks. I've used them in my stores in Cincinnati for years, and I'm installing them in my new store, which is opening soon. Visit their website today at draintroughs.com and contact your distributor to order your drain trough today.
Okay. So that's not what you have today. So how, what happened to what you have today? How did that switch come?
So it was very interesting. I'll transition to where we are today, kind of just happened by the circumstances we were presented with and then options that came along, and we just opened our minds and said, let's just run with it and test it as we go. So we started out originally self-service and drop-off. Drop-off business was good when my dad was there running it with his team. And then we really looked at it and said, how could we grow it more? So we started advertising, Facebook, Instagram, and the drop-off picked up a little bit. And then it picked up a little more. Then we started looking at the numbers and we were pretty much doubling every month. So we didn't have a lot of space upstairs because we packed the store full of machines. And then we had the attendance booth. So we started using our basement space. We were super fortunate. We would put the drop-offs in the basement. We had an elevator to bring the orders up and down. And we started running out of room. And one night I'm in the store and I'm just looking at the one of the attendants taking care of clients and then clients coming in to drop off orders and the time it's taking us to take care of them. And I was like, well, you know, we really run two different businesses here. Drop off is totally different than self-service. I agree with having it part of the self-service laundromat and the economic models and using the attendants' time wisely. But when I really sat down and looked at it, I was like, we're serving two different clients and we're not servicing them to the fullest. And then it just clicked. And I talked to Jess about it and we were just banging it around, figuring out what do we do. And then a couple of days later, maybe a week later, I'm in the store. I look up one of our clients who's across the street from us. She has a seamstress business and she would drop off clothes for us to clean that she would donate to charity. And she's like, yeah, I'm leaving. The landlord's raising my rent. This guy is crazy. And I was like, you're leaving? She's like, yeah, I'm moving from across the street. And the light, and then the broker was hanging up the sign and it clicked in my head. I was like, what if we put the drop-off business across the street and separate it from the self-service? We could really cater to the clients a lot better. I took a picture and texted it to Jess and she was just like, call the broker now. And I was just like, okay. And then we separated the drop-off. And at that point, we had started doing a little bit of pickup and delivery. We really weren't playing with pickup and delivery. So we moved the drop off across street. We totally came up with a separate company, rebrand, different brand, the Soapbox. And that was all drop off. And our clients went across street and they loved it. Like we built it for them. The whole counter, everything was set up for someone coming to drop off quick and get back out, or if they're coming to pick up. And then after that, we started playing with pickup and delivery.
Okay.
We got a little interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. I know you have a unique model and we want to dig into that too, but what was the transition like? Were you transitioning from, I think you said the laundromat was in the back of the building. Is that what you said?
Correct.
So you didn't have road frontage. You didn't have good visibility. I'm assuming, correct me if I'm wrong. When you moved across the street, were you moving across the street? I know to separate the businesses, but were you doing it because you were going to get a lot more visibility? You were, I'm assuming this is a pretty densely populated area and you knew the business would grow that much, or what was your, or did you already have enough business that you were just like, I got to get out of this laundromat?
Yeah. Well, the space was really what was getting us. So we saw we were running out of space. And was that the best, you know, metrics for us to say, is the business growing? No. But when we were running out of space and orders just kept coming in, I was like, I think we're doing something right. So let's figure out. And even though we were on the back of the building, because it was the avenue, my dad had blown out some of the walls over time and put in glass. So when people drove down the avenue, they could see like the washes, and we had, he had a, like, my dad had the huge, like, this has got to be the biggest sign I've ever seen in a business in Brooklyn. The sign was at least 10 feet tall. Wow. And at least 45 feet long. And he put these huge lights on it and it was just like, Cope Brothers Laundromat. And I was just like, God, that's the biggest thing I've ever seen in my life.
So visibility wasn't an issue.
Yeah, and he lit up the street. So when you drove down the street at night, you were like, wow, what is that? Like a spaceship over there? Oh, it's a laundromat. It was so bright. So when we went across the street, it actually was the exact opposite. There is, we have really no window space or anything. We have a little small window. You know, we laugh at the store. The name of the business is the Soapbox, But we laugh because it's literally a box. It's a brick, a one-story box. We've got one window that's maybe, I don't know, 4x4. And wow. Everything else is brick. Like okay. we're just in there. So we
put a lot of signs. How big is that space?
700 square feet.
Okay.
Wow.
Yeah. So we sit on top of each other when we're in there working.
Yeah.
And that's enough room for all of your drop-off? Does it have a basement?
It does, but we don't utilize it. But we're going to have to start soon. So what made it super interesting, when we were doing drop-off, it was no problem. We got into pickup and delivery, and we only got up in the, and listen, I'll tell you both, straightforward. I had no desire ever to do pickup and delivery, mm-hmm. nor dry cleaning. So we do dry cleaning, sneaker cleaning, and drop-off. I should say wash and fold. We had no desire to do dry cleaning, and I had no desire to do pickup and delivery. I was like, the logistics are too much. Like, you got to deal with the drivers and picking up. And listen, people talk about delivery in our industry. You both know this is very complicated because it's two-way for our industry. Mm-hmm. Every other right. industry is just one way. Like, they drop it off. We got to get it and get it back to them. It's a lot of moving parts to it. Mm-hmm. So, and I remember this like it was yesterday. There was an older lady who was a client in a store. She did our laundry on a regular basis. And she was like, you should do pickup and delivery, Waleed. And I was like, yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. She was like, if you did it, I would use it. That would be a great service for the community. And I was like, mm-hmm, okay. And she did this for like a couple months. And then one night she came in the store and she said it. And I don't know, I was just in one of those moods. And I was like, you know what? Okay, grandma, if I'm going to do it, just stop asking me. I'm going to do it tonight.
She broke you down.
She totally broke me. Like, my spine was in two places. She snapped. I was just like, why is she doing this to me? Like, and she was very nice about it. And she was like, I'm telling you, you should do it. And this is the crazy part about it. And, you know, and I reflect on it now in life and think about other things that go on. Messages and things come to us in all kind of packages and all kind of ways. And we have to be so open to them and just and receive them for what they are and not judge the packaging or how they're being delivered to us. Mm. And I say that to say, she said it to me over months. And that night I went home, I added it to our website and I hacked some app together with a pickup and delivery for drivers and an API. And I was like, it works. Here comes the orders. And I sat there and I was just looking at my inbox the other day at our first order that came in. The first order came in and I was like, wow, this really wasn't as complicated as I thought it would be. So then pickup and delivery started happening.
So just to pause there, was that you doing all the delivery? I mean,
yeah, what did that seems business awfully look like? Quick.
You were just like, oh yeah, I just decided to do pickup and delivery tonight. It's working. Yeah. Like, yeah. I need a little more information.
You went from working 60 hours a week to 100 hours a week.
Yeah. I reached out to whoever's in charge of daylight savings times, and I was like, listen, I need you to push this thing 2 hours back. I need more time in the day. So like, I just did it. And I built it that night. I turned it on and I downloaded a bunch of emails from our software and I emailed everybody and was like, officially Koch Brothers and Sons Laundromat now does pickup and delivery. And I kept it under the store's name because we had just started doing the soapbox and everybody wasn't familiar with that brand yet. And an order came in and I was like, okay. And I would get up in the morning from about 6 or 7, I think it was around like 6:30. I would do deliveries from about 7 a.m. to about 9, then meet with Jess, and then we would drive to the office, do work in the office, and then I'd drive back to Brooklyn with her, and then around like 5:30, I would pick up whatever evening orders, and I would deliver those to like 8, 8:30. She would ride with me sometime, depending how crunched for time we were coming back from the office. And I did that for maybe, I don't know, close to a year. And then it just kept picking up and picking up, and I was like, oh, I guess we're on to something here. And then we hired a manager to manage both the stores at once. And then they started doing some deliveries. And then we just kept building it from that momentum. Yeah.
So wow. You make it sound so simple. How big of an area were you covering? Because I know for us, like, how many square miles do we cover?
Well, it's less now, but at one point we covered almost 500 square miles.
Yeah, I'm guessing your area wasn't that big.
So
we've condensed it down, but yeah.
So, and this is one thing we thought about, and I mentioned it at the conference too. And I had just read some case studies on other businesses. And I mentioned a conference, MCI, which is a long distance phone company, and a couple of others, and how they microed down. Mm-hmm. And we focused on one neighborhood, which was the neighborhood the store was in, Bedford-Stuyvesant. 150,000 people in that neighborhood. And the neighborhood is roughly, I'm going to guess, the furthest to the border from our store is maybe a mile. And the other direction, maybe a mile and a half. So it's not super big, but it's super condensed. And our focus was, if we saturate this one neighborhood and get traction, then we span to other neighborhoods. So to answer your question, the short version is one neighborhood at that time.
Yeah.
Maybe two square miles.
So low square miles, but high population. Because you know, if we went 2 square miles, we would hit 100 people. not quite that bad, but.
Yeah, because everything in my market is vertical, where your market is horizontal.
Yeah.
But there are pros and cons to each, because you have access to people's porches. Mm-hmm. We don't have that.
Yeah. I want to push pause here for a second and point out something that I think we all know and agree on, us three. For everybody listening out there, you know, I've always said one of the most powerful things we can do in any industry, in any business, is connect with each other and learn from each other. I've also always said, and I probably don't say it enough, one of the most dangerous things we can do is just assume that you can copy what Dave or Waleed does in your market and it will work. Because that's rarely true. Now, there are some markets that are very similar. There are some parts of the country that are very similar. But you can also go in bigger cities and you go from one side of the city to the other and it's like a different world almost. And so I think it's really important that we understand when we're networking, like at the Laundromat Millionaire Conference and things like that, we have to keep these things in context, right? So it can't just be, hey, you're successful or you're rich or whatever. You do X. I need to do X. That's why I always say what we should be doing in this environment, and this just kind of goes to the how I've learned how to manage and grow our business, is I always call them golden nuggets. Every conversation that I have, I'm not looking to copy what you're doing because I know that's not likely feasible. But what I'm looking to do is, what are those nuggets? What are those ideas where I'm like, hey, that works. That's something that's transferable. And I say it all the time. She mentioned it before we started recording today, but one of the things that's really powerful in business is we can use those lessons that are transferable from industry to industry too. I've learned so much about making my pickup and delivery business successful from friends of mine that are in the restaurant business.
Yep.
How is that? People say, that sounds crazy to me. It's all about this mindset and how do you go into these conversations? And the reason I want to pull this out and point it out really quickly in this conversation is your business, your pickup and delivery business is very successful. Our pickup and delivery business is very successful. If I moved to your market and tried to do what I'm doing, I'd be a fool and vice versa. And there's 600 other versions of those within those two. So even if you're hiring a mentor or a coach or something like that, I always like to remind people, because I do mentoring and coaching and I know it's something you're getting into, Waleed, I always like to remind both sides. We as the coaches, the mentors, the guidance, we have to remind ourselves not to get too over our skis with what we know and what we don't know. Yep. And we have to get to know them and their community. And we have to ask the right questions. We have to do investigative work. And that's why sometimes coaching and mentoring doesn't happen quickly. It's also why not everybody's good at it. So I don't know if that makes sense, but I feel like a big part of why we do this podcast is just to bring value to the small business community. A lot of our audience are laundromat owners and pickup and delivery and things like that. But more and more of them every day are just small business owners from other industries. And we like to try to pull these golden nuggets from our guests and from our life experience. And I think how to teach, let me rephrase that. I think teaching others how to learn is important, because we all automatically just assume we just need the information. Waleed, just tell me what you do. That's it. Just tell me what you do and I'll do it. And that is fool's gold.
We know how that goes.
Right. That's fool's gold, guys. So anyway, I just wanted to point that out because you're very successful with what you do. You have a very, very, very different business model than we do in Cincinnati. And they both work.
Right.
And if I win in your market, I would be a fool to try to replicate my business model in your market. And if you came into my market, you'd have two customers because there aren't 150,000 people in six counties in Cincinnati. We're not rural, but I mean, we're like the whole metro area of Cincinnati, the entire suburbs, the city, right. Everything is roughly a million people. Like you can walk out your front door and throw a baseball and hit a million people. So like we got to keep these things in context. You know what I mean? And then there's other people like they, you know, they might live in Alabama. There might be 25,000 people in the whole town and they'd have to drive for an hour to get to another town or city. So we need to keep these things in context. That way we can bring each other value and we can make sure that we're learning the right way. Because it is education just isn't always as simple as having the data, having the information. So anyway, I went on my soapbox. You're welcome. I went on my soapbox for a minute there, but I think that's really, really, really important. And we talked about this a little bit at the conference, right? Because I tried to set the stage and I didn't want to spend too much time on it at the conference of like, guys, my vision of this Laundromat Millionaire conference that we did and we're going to continue to do in the future is really about that. It's really about us all networking, getting together, but us also coming at it from the right frame of mind. I mean, the panel that you were on, you were up there, very successful. There was three other pickup and delivery operators that are all very successful. You're all very different in the way you run your business, maybe even your risk tolerance. And that's why I put that panel together. As I said, like, I don't want you guys arguing, but I do want you debating. I want us all to reach in there and grab those gold nuggets that work for us. That's not always easy to do. It's certainly not clean cut. You know, everybody says like, oh, I just need a spreadsheet. Just give me a formula. That's all I need. And I'm like, man, you're chasing a wild rabbit. That's a dangerous thing to do. So anyway, let's get back to your story, but I think that's really important for us to keep that in context. So I'm curious, can you hit some of the numbers for us? Like when you launched pickup and delivery, what were you charging? I know you had vans. You talked about that you were using your old brand, but then you transitioned. What was that process like? And then what are you charging nowadays? And what does your business model look like now?
Yeah. So if we jump back to what I was charging then, if whatever number I tell you and Carla, I'll be totally lying. let me set some context here.
Okay.
And part of it was set when grandma came in and said, you should do pickup and delivery. And I was just like, okay.
Did you ask her how much you should charge? Like,
no, I didn't. Like,
I just didn't. Was she your first order?
I'm glad you asked that, Paula. I didn't mention that during the whole story. And we were talking about how information comes to us and these things happen in life. She bugged me for months. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, this lady never made an order. Never. Never. And then, like, I haven't seen her since. I think I saw her 2 weeks ago in the street, but I'm not sure 100% if that was her. Like, this COVID with these masks and everything, I can't tell anymore. Because I'm like, to the point now, like, was she just someone who just came into my life to say, you need to do this thing, and this thing is going to lead us to, you know, where we are today.
She was your little business advice angel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. She never made an order. Like, and I'm just like, wow, can you believe this? Like, I love her. So, you know, where we are now, where we charge $1.61 a pound if you bring it to us, if we pick it up from you, and $1.31 if you bring it to our store. We're probably in the, I'd say, the lower middle price range of our market.
Okay.
Pricing was a little difficult for us, and I'll give you some background. So stepping into a business that's been around for years with your name on the wall, it's tricky when you have to make some changes versus if I would have brought this business from someone else who was running the business, and then I'm like, hey, under new management, put a sign up and then put new name on the wall. It's easy to go from, you know, 0 to 100. It's going to be some pushback, but it's not the same. So pricing for us has been really tricky. Because my dad hadn't raised prices consistently over time. So we did one huge, in the store, we made a big transition. We were quarters. Then I went to tokens because I got tired of quarters. And then we went to a kiosk type system called Laundry Boss. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you're familiar with them. And we put the QR codes on the machines. And then we had a kiosk where people could swipe their card or put cash in and start the machines, kind of like the gas station model. Mm-hmm. And once I did that, we had to raise the price. Well, we raised the price before that. Then I raised the price again. Mm-hmm. And I had pushed one customer, walked across the street while I was in the soapbox, because the store and the soapbox across the street from each other. So we were running back and forth all day pushing carts in the middle of the street. I swore somebody was going to get hit by a car one day. Mm. Thank goodness it never happened. And she came across to the soapbox. She's like, "Where's Cope? I need to speak to him now." And I was like, "Hey, how you doing? How can I help you? You need to justify to me why you raised these prices." And I was like, "Okay, let's sit down. Let's have a talk. Let's talk economics 101. I was like, "Didn't the governor and the mayor just say minimum wage is going up dramatically in New York City to like $3? And she's like, "Yeah." And I was like, "How many people you see working here?" 13. Okay. Now. Mm-hmm. And I was like, "We have a new system in the store. We've upgraded this in the store." I was like, "And there's inflation. There's utilities." She was like, "Well, these are Manhattan prices. This is ridiculous. You shouldn't be charging this in this neighborhood." And I was like, "Well, what should I be charging?" So that became a whole nother conversation. So raising prices has been very tricky for us, but we've got it down to a science now. We raise our prices twice a year. It's on the calendar, and we have a set percentage that we increase it. And that percentage gets broken down for, you know, inflation, cost of living for our team member, raises, bonuses, and just our expenses. And we stick to it. And since that one, you know, big elevation we had back then, we really don't get any pushback about it. And listen, in every other industry, prices go up. Mm-hmm. I don't understand when I read the forums, and I'm in some of the groups, and people are like, "I'm going to raise my prices. What should I do?" I'm like, mm-hmm. "Raise them." Mm-hmm. Like, what else is there to do? Like, are you supposed to announce it and email to everybody? Name me, like, besides a business like healthcare or something where you have a contract with, name me one business that when they raise their prices, they notify every one of their clients.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you don't walk into Target and they're like, "By the way, Snickers went up on the door." Right. You know, $1.50.
Glad you said Snickers. I love those. So we're on the same page.
Me too.
They don't. So I'm like, why do we have to? And I get it. We're a community business, et cetera, mm-hmm. et cetera. But we really have to think about our mindset running a business as well as supporting our community. Mm-hmm. You know, they go hand in hand, but at the same time, they're two different things. Mm-hmm.
Can you reflect on that for a second? I think this is important conversation, Waleed. You said they go hand in hand. And I know, by the way, we haven't mentioned it, but I want to give a shout out because Waleed and his wife have a podcast. So if y'all are watching this, if you're not checking out Commerce and Chill, which is a super cool name, by the way, podcast, you should go check that out. That's a business podcast. And it's really well done. They put a lot of work and blood, sweat, and tears into it. And I know that's not all about the laundry business too. Is it a small business podcast? Is that what you would describe it as? Yeah. Okay.
It's a podcast that covers being married, being in business, running businesses, and all of the above. So
nice.
Anything is liable to come out on their podcast depending on what happened.
Gotcha. I've caught several episodes and it's fantastic. So anyway, you guys could check it out. But Waleed, can you dissect what you just said for a little bit? You know, I think this is really important that, you know, I'm not sure how many consumers watch this show, but I guess we're all consumers in a way. Mm-hmm. I think it's really important that small business owners understand that by not raising our prices, we're not doing anyone a service there. So you talked about the fact, I'm going to put words in your mouth now. You talked about the fact that service to your community and raising prices are directly correlated is roughly what you said. Can you dissect that a little bit?
Yeah. So like I look at it this way, and there's two sides of it. There's in-house and then there's out of the house. And when I say out of the house, we're talking about our clients in the community. And then in-house is our team members. Mm-hmm. So let's be absolutely clear. In business, if our team doesn't show up, nothing happens. Mm-hmm. None of us would be on this podcast if everybody didn't show up at your stores and everybody didn't show up at my stores and our other business. We'd all be running around trying to figure out what to do. So it's super important. And COVID hit, this happened in our store. All of our team, we were fortunate to get named essential in the laundry business, mm-hmm. which I was so grateful for. And I was more grateful for my team than myself. Mm-hmm. Because my business goes out tomorrow, I'll figure something out. We're entrepreneurs. It's what we do. What are they going to do? So we had a team meeting and the team said, I said, listen, COVID, they're talking about businesses are going to be closing. This thing is getting really bad. We're going to have a vote and everybody has 100% say. You don't have to, there's no pressure. And you all vote first. I have no say in this. Do we want to stay open or do we close? And every one of them said, what are you talking about? we're going to go out there and get all this laundry because everybody else is closing. and we worked. And I say that to say the team is super important. So if we're not raising prices, how do you compensate your team properly? Mm-hmm. Like, I am on a mission. People have no idea. Like, my team, I'm fighting. We're going to have healthcare, retirement plans, every kind of perk. My team gets paid weeks vacation. They get sick days. They get every perk you hear someone talking about at some tech firm or some Fortune 500 company. Why the heck can't we have those same benefits and incentive for someone who, whether, and this hourly wage worker, like, I don't even like those terms, but I'm going to use it because that's how they classify the business arena, the hourly wage worker. Why can't they have the same benefits and perks as some of these upper level positions or these other firms, right? Whatever we want to call them. I'm on a mission to break that barrier and put that in every one of my stores. So yeah, like I've already added more stores to Soapbox. Like I'm on a mission already.
Nice. Just in this, I love it.
Conversation, right?
I didn't bat an eye. No.
But that's another thing. But we can have a separate conversation about it. And in the industry, you brought it up earlier. Some people equate when they get into this industry that I have to have more locations to have a bigger impact or to make more economics. And that's not always the case, depending on the market that you're in. Like, you really have to think about this differently. So, sir, raising those prices is important to support your team. Forget the profits and the money you make as a business owner. Your team. Your team has to be supported. You need additional revenue to support them. They have to get raises. Cost of living goes up. Then on the other side of it, you need those raises and those increases in the prices to further enhance your community give backs and your community outreach. Wait, listen, and I do, like, I'm kind of crazy. I do stuff off the cuff. As pickup and delivery as an example, I was on in social media and I saw one of our clients got sick. And this client, her and her family use us religiously every week. And I saw her, she got cancer. And I was like, wow. You know, we sent her a card, say, listen, hope you get better. And then she did this piece on how, like an expose on social media about the cost of treating cancer in the healthcare. And she posted one of her bills. It was like $50,000. I almost, like, I dropped my phone when I saw that. And this was like not all her treatments. I think this was like one or two treatments and it was $50,000. I was like, and healthcare was like, we're only going to cover X amount. And I don't even remember it. And I was just so blown away by that. I went to her account and I put $1,000 credit on her account. I looked at how much laundry she did, what the cost was for this period of time. I put $1,000 credit, screenshotted it, and then texted it to her. And was like, you don't have to worry about laundry until you get better. Mm-hmm. So let's be clear. If I didn't have the financial infrastructure with pricing being right, how could I do that? Like, I'll be giving the store away. Or how could I sponsor the bounce house and all the events that they had for the block party that's right around the corner on my grandparents' block with their block association that's right around the corner from our store? We can't do those things without it. So it's super important that our economics are in line to be able to support our team members and to support the communities that we're connected with.
Yeah, I stumbled upon a really smart quote recently, Waleed. It was from me, so I don't know how it was smart, but what ended up happening is I'm talking to a client one day and I was like, you know what? Business is not complicated. It's about people and money. That's it. People and money. Or people in math, whatever you want to insert in there.
And that's what we do with both. It's like what we do with it.
But, you can have the biggest heart in the world. Can you take care of people the way you did with this lady, your employees, the community? If you don't have the money, I mean, I guess if you're independently wealthy, you can. But for those of us that are just running businesses, trying to make a living and serve our communities, that comes from the business. And if you're not running if you're not operating an economically thriving business model, meaning you're serving the community, you're serving your employees, you're giving them all the things you're talking about, and you're thriving as an individual, you can't do that. I don't care how big your heart is. It's just people in math. It's not any more than that. So I appreciate you taking the time to kind of go down that rabbit hole a little bit, because I don't think we realize sometimes, you know, I was at a conference a few years ago now, and I was on a panel, and where it was isn't really relevant, but I was talking, and one of the people in the audience, they asked the panel, they said, you know, how do you feel that your business or how do you feel about corporate responsibility within the context of your business? And I don't think this was a popular answer. And I, you know, I was on a panel, so I didn't get enough time to really answer it. But I said, you know, I think that the answer to that starts, and I didn't say it stops, but it starts with operating a viable, profitable business. Yeah. Because that's a great way to serve your community. Like, the giveaways are great. The raises, the things that our employees earn with retirement and healthcare and things like that, those are all great. But if your business isn't healthy, that's gone. It's gone. Stopped. It doesn't exist. So I feel like we start and stop in that environment. And then while we flourish, where we have all these other opportunities and we say, hey, I see this need over here. I can go meet that need like the lady you're describing.
That's it. I was reading a book, and I don't remember what book it was. And the author said, you really want to help people? Become rich. Mm. He's like, because then you will have the money and the time to do these things, because the money is going to free you up in certain aspects. And then you'll have the resources to help individuals.
Yeah.
And rich is relevant. He didn't say you have to be a gajillionaire. Mm-hmm. Rich is relevant. So if it puts you where you need to be, and then you have extra money to do these things, it's so important. If we're not running a viable business, what is this, charity? Like, mm-hmm. I'm sorry. Like, I don't mean to be cold, but this, we're talking, if we're separating business from, it's business. The numbers have to make sense at mm-hmm. the end of the day. Like, bottom line is important. Like, and you mm-hmm. spoke about this, and it drives me crazy when I hear people talking about, oh, my top line revenue. And I'm like, mm-hmm, sure. Mm-hmm.
What's your top line? Doesn't mean anything.
Right.
It's all relative. Okay.
So you gross $10 million. Okay. But your expenses are like $9 million plus. So what happened?
Yep.
Let's shift the conversation and talk about what are our margins and mm-hmm. what are we putting in that bottom line? What are we doing to impact the bottom line? And that's mm-hmm. not a conversation that happens in small and mid-sized businesses a lot in our communities. It's just not. And we really need to change that narrative mm-hmm. so people understand what is going on at the bottom line so I can make my business more viable. And whatever your goal might be, you want to hand it off to the next generation. If your goal is to sell it, if your bottom line is not looking good, how much return mm-hmm. on that? How many X are you going to get on that? Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
I think as small businesses, we focus so much on growth. So we look at that top line. Am I growing? Am I growing? Am I growing? And I know this happened with us with pickup and delivery in the beginning. We were growing like crazy and we were losing more and more money every month. And finally, I'm like, Dave, we got to stop growing because we're losing all our money.
We're going to grow ourselves right. bankrupt.
But we had to focus on the costs and we had to focus on that bottom line. So. Right. I think a lot of small businesses, they're guilty of just looking for that growth and that top line revenue. So,
yeah, that's exactly right. And the other thing I'll throw in there, and then we want to hear about your model today, because I'm still intrigued by your model. I love it. I love the creativity behind it and then where you're going in the future. But the last thing I want to throw out there is there's also something to be said for reinvesting in your business, because you can have a healthy, thriving business today. And if you're not constantly reinvesting in your business diligently, repeatedly, you won't have it for long. I don't know how long. I don't have the answer. Right. Might be 2 years, might be 20 years, but you won't have it for long. And I see that happen a lot too, where people set up an economic business model where they take care of their people and they serve, mm-hmm. They take care of their family and they give to their community. And they forget about the fact of reinvesting, the capital improvements or whatever category we want to throw them in. We have to account for those things within our business model, within our margins and things like that. And, some people do it every year. I spend X amount in my store, and some people put it in a separate savings account. And every 10 years, they hit it with a nice injection. However you want to do it, doesn't matter, but you have to be accounting for that. So it's so funny because I'm a big proponent of us, you know, raising our prices and having healthy margins. And I get attacked so often by people that just refer to me as greedy and that's unnecessary and all these things. And all I know is that the economics work and my model is thriving and more profitable tomorrow than it is today, which means that I can reinvest in my business. I can reinvest in my community. I can reinvest in my employees. I can do all the things I want to do because at the end of the day, the way me and Carla run our life is we want to be better tomorrow than we were yesterday. Right. We don't want to just give. If we're talking about giving, we don't want to just give the same amount we gave last year. We want to give more. That's right.
Right.
So I'm greedy. I want
what I did last year. That's right. Because if I wowed you last year with X, I want to wow you with Y and the following year. You're like, wow, like you did more.
Yep.
Like, exactly. Where do we get more from?
Yep. Like, and that's where that math and that people come into it. Anyway, thank you for indulging me because I know it's something you're passionate about. It's something Carla and I are very passionate about. Quite frankly, I don't believe for a second. I believe most people are good. Maybe I'm a little naive. I know not everybody is, but most people are good people and they really want to do the right thing. And we put this conversation in the context of small business. I really truly believe most small business owners would love to be in a position where they can do all the things we're talking about. And I think this conversation, which can be uncomfortable if you don't let people get the full thought process out, it can come across as I just need a Lambo or whatever. And that's not really the context of this conversation. Right. So anyway.
And a Lambo is fine if that's what you want. I like
building your business model.
Somebody might want a Lambo and you know somebody else wants some, I don't know, $20,000 washer in their store. Mm-hmm. Like either one is fine. It's just, it's what you want to do. Listen, this is what I tell some of my team members. It's not how much money we make. It's how we make our money. Mm-hmm. That's so important. So if you make your money the right way and you're doing the right things, you can spend it on a Lambo. That's your prerogative. You can spend it on a $20,000 watch, whatever you want. But let's just make sure what we're doing in the business for the community and for our team members at that business makes total sense.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because I grew up really poor. I don't know if you've read my story, but I grew up really poor in Flint, Michigan. And when I started to find some different levels of success, it probably wasn't one period. It was probably a roller coaster where I started to feel pretty guilty. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden it hit me one day. I was like, you know what? I've never earned a dollar at someone else's expense.
Right.
Every dollar I've earned in my life has been in servitude to others.
And once when you said you felt guilty,
I felt guilty when I reached a certain level of success, a level of success that was, yes, with money that wasn't, that was inordinate.
I have this and other people are going with it.
Yeah. I felt guilty because I knew what it was like to be middle class. I knew what it was like to be poor. And I was like, I kind of feel guilty, that I found that I'm, you know, in this situation and I'm blessed the way that I am. And then I started to kind of dissect it, had some conversations with some really wise people, things like that. And I realized, okay, well, I should only feel guilty if I've done that in a predatory way. Right. Like then you shouldn't sleep well at night. And I'll never like disagree with you otherwise. But the fact of the matter is if you have a healthy business that's serving your community, serving your team members, thriving, growing, you're reinvesting, you're better tomorrow – you should be proud of that. And once again, we should try to do more of that because that's what truly, I mean, that is capitalism, right? I mean, that's the beauty of being in a free market, you know, free market as we are anymore. But anyway, that's the beauty of, relatively free. That's the beauty of the situation that we're in. And, you know, it was really eye-opening for me because there are still people today, you know, the whole Laundromat Millionaire thing and stuff. There's people today that still try to encourage me to feel guilty for being successful. And I'll have that conversation with anyone, but we're not going to have half a conversation. We're going to have the whole conversation.
You
got to have the context.
It's contextual.
Yep.
You know, yeah. And it's, listen, that's, I'm glad you brought that up. And that's a conversation that really needs to happen in our business community more often, especially with small and mid-sized operators. There's this culture that's been put out there that you need to feel like money is bad. And you need to feel guilty or you're evil if you have a lot of money. And a lot of that has to do with what the media has put out because of these kajillionaires and the picture that they paint. And then there's, you know, a certain agenda that different parties have about taxes and all that. But it's trickled down to say, like, you know, I'm a bad person if I have a lot of money. Yep. And people need to understand, it's, listen, money is a byproduct. Mm-hmm. Money is not the, we're not, like, there are some entrepreneurs in it for the money. Let's make no mistake. Mm-hmm. But majority of entrepreneurs in my circle, and I talk, they're not in it for the money. Money is this byproduct. It's the fuel that runs mm-hmm. this machine. It's mm-hmm. the lubricant that keeps this thing going. Like, we're doing it for other reasons. And the money comes because we're so passionate, or we're delivering this value to the marketplace that wants that. And then the money is what we get in return for doing it. Mm-hmm. But listen, it goes back to what you said earlier. You got, your pricing has to be in the right place for your business to survive and thrive, or your clock is going to be, it's going to wind out really fast, really fast.
Yeah.
And
that's when
you don't serve anyone.
Mm-hmm, that's when burnout happens and all these different things.
You'll be stressed out. Like, trust me, I grew up in that. Like, my moms would turn the heat off at night during the winter so our gas bill wouldn't be that high. And we wrapped up in extra blankets and then turned the heat back on in the morning just to get ready for school, and then shut it back off when we walked out the door. Mm-hmm. And then we learned a lesson, like, your house can't get too cold because then your pipes are bust. Yeah. And I was like, oh, well, we better turn the heat up a little bit more. Yeah,
that's exactly
like,
right.
Listen, I get it. Like, money is it's not evil. It's money is an amplifier. If someone is evil, if someone is a bad person, it's just like social media. Social media doesn't make people bad, and money doesn't make people bad. It amplifies who we are.
I like that.
You're an idiot, you're just an idiot with a lot more money. That's it. You're a broke idiot or you're a rich idiot. You're still an idiot. Mm. Like, you're a bad person, you're a good rich, you're a bad rich person, or you're a bad poor person. It doesn't change us. Yep. Like, it just amplifies who we are.
Yeah. My mentor told me years ago, his dad actually taught him, he said, money is just a way of keeping score. And you said, I think a byproduct, you said it's a byproduct of serving people. And I think we need to always remember that, be reminded of that, and not apologize for that.
It's nothing wrong with having a mindset to say, I want to build some level of wealth for myself, for my family, for my future family, for my relatives, even my friends. Right. Mm-hmm. Like, I laugh and joke with people all the time. I'm like, listen, New York style pizza has 8 slices. I was like, I probably, if I was super greedy, could probably eat 5 of those. My stomach would hurt, but I'd be like, I'm full. Like, yeah. And there's 3 left over. But if I ate 2, I would probably be comfortable, and I can invite way more people to the table to eat with me versus me trying to eat all 8 myself. I'd rather have the meal with more people at the table and enjoy it. Mm-hmm. And then while we're at that table, we figure out, how do we buy another pizza together? Or how do we make a pizza? How do we all grow together versus mm-hmm. me trying to consume it all myself? Mm-hmm. So yeah, spread the wealth.
Yeah, that's a great metaphor. Fantastic.
Let's jump back into your story. So as we close this out, Waleed, let's take a few minutes. Tell us about your business model today and tell us how you got to that point and where you're going in the future with that model.
So our model is, and Carla, you asked a great question earlier that I never answered. You said, we're 700 square feet, and how do we get all this laundry in this store? So at one point, for drop-off, it worked well. And then we transitioned to pickup and delivery. Our volume increased dramatically because now we're not just serving people who walk or drive a couple blocks to come to the store. Now we're running out and bringing it in. So our volume just exponentially grew. But we realized in the model, if we can rotate the orders, we don't need more space. So we've pivoted a couple of times. So our model now is, we're strictly drop off and pick up and delivery. We don't have self-service anymore. So either 2020 or September 2019, I'm sorry, I'm bad with dates, we stopped doing self-service 100%.
So the location across the street, did you sell that, or did that become storage area?
So that's a whole nother thing. So I really don't talk about it much. And I've only mentioned it one other place, I think. Whatever it was, 2020 or September 2019, my dad and I had a conversation. He was like, yeah, you know, so listen, it's business, the lease. We need to talk about the rent. I was like, okay, cool. Let's talk about the rent. And he was like, this is going to be the new rent. And I looked at the number and I was just like, this includes you getting a cut of the revenue or just the rent? Like, are you stepping away from being part of the business and just want to be the landlord? And he was like, no, it's both. So I was like, okay. And I looked at the number and I was like, we can't do that number. And then when I said we, not me, talking about the business. And this is where we, where, mm-hmm. you know, family dynamics and business, you got to separate. I was like, mm-hmm. the business can't do that number. Let's be clear. And he was like, well, this is the number I want, is the landlord. And I was like, I totally respect it. I was like, I'll get back to you. And I thought about it and I was like, we're not doing it. So we won't have a store anymore. And then right about then is when I need to change my underwears, when I made that decision. And I was like, Jess, we're going 100% on drop off and pick up and delivery. And she was like, what? I was like, yeah, this is the number pop ones for rent, AKA the landlord. And she was like, yeah, I don't think, like, we could have done it, but it just there wouldn't have been enough for us to reinvest and grow the business. And I was like, it's a stretch. So I was like, we're going to go 100% pick up and delay. And at that point, to bring you up to speed, we had already closed the store probably 4 days out of the week at that point for self-service, because we were doing all the drop-offs in the store those 4 days. And we were even running a team at night. So we were already kind of transitioning to pick up and drop off only. And that just accelerated for us. So I was so happy Pop, AKA the landlord, was like, yeah, this is the new rent, because it pushed us. It made us uncomfortable. Mm. And the more we keep putting ourselves in uncomfortable situations, I swear, the more success we have. Mm-hmm. So we made that transition. So
How did that work though? Like, because when you lost the self-serve laundromat, you also lost your facility for your pickup and delivery. So
yeah, so that's why I had to change my underwears. So
they put washers and dryers on the roof.
Right. I was like, how are we gonna process all these orders now? Like that was a whole nother thing. And again, those uncomfortable situations, they bring out the entrepreneur in you. They make you really think, they make you invent. Like, what is that saying? Like, necessity is the mother of invention, or something like that. And it made us really think. And at that time, I was reading a book. Well, I had just read a book before called Power. I believe it's called Power Economics. And it talks about cooperative economics, like building economics in the community, and how money leaves a community, and how the average dollar is spent in the community. And it compared like different communities, how dollars stay within some communities longer than they do in other communities. So on that, it talks about how do you build other businesses up in the community along with you. And I'm super into cooperative economics. So I talked to a colleague who has a laundromat, and I was like, hey, like, how many turns you get a day? And he was like, not enough. I was like, what if we could turn your machines at night or in late afternoon when your store is slow? He was like, yeah. So I was like, cool, listen, I got a team. I want to train your team, and we're going to do laundry in your store. He was like, I don't care. Let's figure this out. So we started doing that. And then went from, in our industry, it's called wholesaling. But I don't consider it wholesaling the way we do it. It's more of a partnership. And it was kind of a nightmarish dealing with, a couple different, because of the mindset. Their mindset was, I just want to get more pounds. They weren't like trying to deliver a quality product. So we dealt with a couple different partners. And to where we are today, we have two partners that we work with Wash and Fold. And we go to their stores, we train their team members. They do it exactly to our standards, do it to the T how we want it. We do inspections, we go by the store, we have great relationships with them. And their model is they want to do commercial laundry. So they, at night, they have a team member who does it. And then another colleague, they have another side of their store that they devote just to commercial, because they have a large facility. So it works out great for us. And what I love more now is, granted, we don't hire as many teamers as used to. We had like 12, 13 team members. Now we're like five, but we're super lean. But the impact we have on the community is way greater, because now the money that we're sending to those businesses, it impacts one businesses in another borough from us. So now we're impacting that neighborhood in that borough. The other businesses, they're in a neighboring neighborhood. We get to impact their team members, their community, their business. So it's a huge win for us. And, not putting, their business out there, but some of our vendors, like, they get a couple $100,000 a year from us, just, working with us as a partner. And I sit down with them and figure out, like, how can we do more? So, we're 700 square feet. We have no washes, no dryers. And our model is, the orders have to rotate as fast as possible. So as soon as they're coming in, we're notifying our clients that your order's ready or it's going on the truck to go get delivered. Well, I shouldn't say the truck, but the dashers are coming in because we have no drivers now. We use DoorDash 100% for our pickup and delivery. So we'll notify the client and then the client will schedule the delivery. And then a dasher shows up like in 10, 15 minutes and the orders are out the door now. So we can rotate that 700 square feet. You know, we turned it into 2,100 square feet because mm-hmm. we're able to rotate that shelf space so fast.
Okay. So describe for people within your business model before we go. We don't want to leave that out there because you just said dashers, like, oh yeah, just dashers, DoorDash.
Okay.
Tell our audience how you run a pickup and delivery full service business model and you have no washers and dryers, you have no drivers and no vehicles.
Right. So someone goes onto our website, client, and they make an order. That order, we have a partnership with our business management software and DoorDash. And that order comes in, goes to DoorDash. DoorDash dispatches a dasher to their house, picks up the order, brings it straight to our store. They drop it off, we tag it, we do what we gotta do, and then we start the processing part of it on the back end. Once it's done, we rack it, usual routine, goes on the shelf. We send a notification, client says, I'm ready to have it delivered. Dasher shows up, we hand it to the dasher and it's out the door. And sometimes it's in a matter of like minutes. Like mm-hmm. we'll hit the notify client button to say your order's done. They get a text from us and then we'll see a dasher like 10 minutes later. Literally, sometimes we have dashers just sitting in front of our store waiting for orders to pop up on their app.
They know it's going to.
Wow.
Right. Yeah. And we've developed a relationship with the dasher. Some of them show up like 4 or 5 times a day. Like doing orders for us. So there's a lot of conversation in the industry, and I'm sure you've heard it and been a part of it and seen it on the forums and the videos that you cannot do pickup and delivery using gig economy workers. And I'm here to say that's not true. And you said it earlier, what works in one area market might not work in another, but there's pieces we can take from each market and use in our own. Mm-hmm. And we've been a true test to it. We had 6 drivers and we slowly transitioned to having all DoorDash. And we're probably 8 months in on only DoorDash. Mm-hmm. Wow. And we're not looking back either.
Yeah. So you mentioned the system, but you didn't mention the name of it. Let's give them credit where credit's due.
Yeah, we use Sense. We transitioned to Sense September or August last year.
Okay.
And so the orders come in through Sense. Sense feeds it to DoorDash and it's what we do.
Listen, man, how can people reach you? If they want to connect with you, network with you, they know about the Soapbox. Is your website just soapbox.com or tell them how people can get a hold of you?
Sure. Our store, the Soapbox website is soapbox.nyc.
Okay.
We weren't fortunate enough to get .com. Somebody already had it. And to reach me, go to my website, waleedcope.com. On social, I'm really active on LinkedIn. So you can always reach out to me on LinkedIn and on Instagram, but LinkedIn is the main place to catch me.
Awesome. Thanks so much. Guys, quick reminder, Commerce and Chill. How can they find that? They just go on the podcasting platforms. Are you on YouTube?
Yeah.
Put stuff on LinkedIn.
We're on all the podcasting platforms, audio, and we're on YouTube and you can go to our website, commerceandchill.com.
Commerce and Chill. Check out their podcast, guys. Him and his wife, Jessica, are rock stars. So I can't wait to spend more time with you guys at Clean.
It's absolutely gonna be good, man. Look forward to it.
All right. For everybody at home, guys, thanks for joining us. I hope you got a lot of value out of this episode. If you get the opportunity, reach out to Waleed. If you're in the New York area, I know he's a people person and he says, come on, give me the love, welcome it. He'd love for you to come down there, check out his operations. Maybe you'll learn something, maybe he'll learn something, but I'm willing to bet there's probably a little of both that's going to happen in there. So listen, guys, let's keep reaching out to each other. Let's keep connecting, sharing information with each other. Let's keep that abundance mindset that makes us all better. Let's not forget to learn from others outside of the industry too, because it's powerful, powerful stuff. If you're talking to someone, a friend, relative, whatever it is, and you recently read a book and you were like, wow, that book blew my mind. Or you just listened to an episode of Commerce and Chill and you were like, hey, text that episode to XYZ who needs to check that episode out. That's the benefit of the environment that we're in today. We know there's a lot of negatives with social media, technology and all, you know, there's evil that comes with those things. But the fact of the matter is there's a lot of good too. We just have to be intentional about those things. So anyways, guys, Dave Menz in Cincinnati, Ohio, with my beautiful wife, Carla, and my friend, Waleed Cope. Appreciate you guys. We'll see you next time for another episode of the Laundromat Millionaire Show. Take care.